You know, audio is a lot like coffee. There's a cheap way of doing things, there's an expensive way, there is a simple way, and a complicated way. And just know that by watching this video and moving forward on your hobby, if this is your first few days, you have elected the complicated and the expensive way. Okay, so today we're going to be talking about DACs. I am going to break this down as if this is your first day. Like, you may not even have heard of a DAC before watching this video. So we're going to break this down into very, very simple terms so that everybody and anybody can understand. I want to be as accessible as I can here. So we'll start with a very simple question. What is DAC? Well, DAC stands for Digital to Analog Converter. Now, do you need a digital to analog converter? If you're running headphones or speakers, the answer is usually yes. What the purpose of a DAC is it takes a digital signal from your computer, your phone, your laptop, your TV, etc., and it turns it into an analog signal that is able to power and push the drivers in things like headphones and speakers. So you do need a DAC. Now, DACs come in all shapes, sizes, and prices, and range in complexity, but we're gonna be talking about the most common use of a dedicated DAC today. Now, a DAC like this one, which if you look the price up, might seem very steep, but this is not the cheapest that they go. They go much, much cheaper than this, so don't get intimidated by the price. This DAC can be broken up into three sections. You have the interface, which is the front-facing portion of this, the part that you interface with the most. This will display information like your input selection, volume output, very simple things like that. It will also, in some cases, provide some filtering options. Not all DACs have an interface, though. Some are just plug and play, and the settings that it operates under is what it operates under, and they can't be changed. A more complicated and higher-end DAC like this usually offers some flexibility there. Now, the other two sections are the inputs and the outputs along the back, and that's what we're going to be focusing on most today. So what are the inputs and how do you navigate them? So among the most common, you'll have USB, optical, coaxial, and Bluetooth, and a few others, but those are usually less common. In general, high-end DACs will have more options and low-end DACs will have less options, though there are exceptions to these rules on both directions. And in certain circumstances, though not all, like this Topping D10 I have here, the input for the USB also doubles as the power input for this device. So you can send both power and a signal from your computer, for example, into this device and it will power both. Not all DACs operate that way. You'll really want to look at the website for that information. Now, the purpose of the inputs is how your source is going to connect to the DAC to get the digital signal away from it and convert it to analog for an amplifier to amplify the signal for your headphones or your speakers. Now, a couple questions here. Do you need to fill or use all of the inputs? No, not at all. Actually, you only really need to fill or use one input of your selected choice. Now, the reason why they would have all these inputs is for a couple reasons. One, if one port breaks or something, you have a secondary option. Two is that you might have multiple sources. So let's say you wanted to hook up one phone, one TV, and one computer. Well, you can hook up various sources into various input options if you have multiple inputs like this D90 does. Second question, can you hook up multiple inputs at once? You can, but you can't utilize multiple inputs at once. You can only use one input at a time. You can leave them plugged in, but that's where the use of the interface comes in, being able to select which inputs you're using at which time. So with this one, you have, let's say, optical, coaxial, and USB. Well, I can plug in all three and just cycle between coaxial, optical, and USB, depending on the source I want to play. Audiophile question, do any of the inputs sound better than the others? This really depends on who you ask. The intention of today's video is not to really discuss that as much as it is the actual practical application of using them. What you need to know today is that any of these inputs will play sound through the DAC. So it doesn't matter if you're plugging in coaxial or optical or USB or any of the other options like Bluetooth, all of them will produce sound out of it. There is a lot of speculation about which one sounds better, but not my area to cover, I don't think. Now, what input do I use and why? I like USB for a couple of reasons. One, it's in the name, it's universal. So almost everything, every digital device you come across will have some form of USB. iPhones have lightning adapter to USB cables. Androids have USB-C to this specific type of USB. iPads, computers, they all have USB. And so I like the flexibility. Now, if you choose an input like optical, things can get a little bit complicated because not everything runs optical, but some things only run optical. For example, Most laptops do not have optical. In fact, I don't even think I've seen a laptop with optical ever. But TVs rarely have USB audio outputs. They usually only have 3.5 millimeter. Sometimes they have an HDMI or an IIS output, which is another type of input, but a lot less common. But more importantly, they almost always have optical out. Some game consoles also have optical out and don't have USB out. So it really depends on the source you are playing it from. That's why a DAC like this with tons of options is a big benefit. Okay, so we talked about the input stage. Let's talk about the output stage. I want to introduce you to two terms which are going to be the most common output stage types that you will see. And that is going to be XLR and RCA, or balanced for XLR and unbalanced for RCA. So let's break those down. So in the back of most DACs, you will see an output of these two holes that are red and white. Now red is for right and white is for left. Sometimes they are marked left channel, right channel, but not always. Just know that red is almost always the right side. Now this is an RCA output, and you would hook up an RCA cable to this that will go from your DAC to your amplifier. That RCA cable looks a lot like this. Then you have 3-pin XLR. This is a very common balanced output, and these are a much larger hole, and they have, you know, 3 pins, as the name would suggest, inside that hole. Now these are labeled right and left. Unfortunately, they are not color coordinated like the RCAs are. Now this would hook up to a female to male XLR cable like this one, and it would plug from your DAC into your amplifier. Now a couple quick notes on these. Some DACs have both, some DACs have neither, and some DACs have only one. The most common input you will see across all DACs is going to be a RCA. XLR is generally used for balanced DACs, which tend to be a little bit more rare and a little bit more expensive. There are a couple of exceptions, and I hate to do this exception thing, but it does happen, where you have something like this Topping D10, like we talked about already. This has something called a TRS balanced output out the back. Now, that is neither an RCA or an XLR, but unless you're in a studio, TRS is a fairly uncommon type of DAC output. So you won't run across this too much, but if you are looking into a DAC and an amplifier, you will want to make sure that the inputs and the outputs for both are compatible. Okay, so let's build a system and talk about compatibility. So first thing you're gonna do is, if you have your amplifier and your DAC, you are going to plug in your power cable to both. This should be fairly straightforward. It should work like any other power cable. Then what you're going to do is you're going to select the output that you want to use for your DAC. In this case, we're going to be using USB, so I'm going to plug in USB into my computer and USB into the DAC. Now from there, I'm going to select, in this specific circumstance, whether I want RCA or XLR to run from my DAC to my amplifier. That is going to transfer the sonic signal, the analog signal, from the DAC to the amplifier. In this case, we're going to use a XLR cable. Though we don't have to. We can use RCA if we want to, but these are balanced DAC and amp combos, so they are supposed to work with a XLR cable. At this point, this system is a fully functioning system once you turn it on. There are a couple things I want you to double check though. One, on your DAC, you will want to make sure that your input is selected to, in this case, USB or whatever your selection was. Two is that everything has power and is turning on, of course. And three, you're gonna wanna check, in this case, we're using a computer, so we're going to want to set our sound output from our computer to the DAC that we're using, making sure that we're not using either onboard audio or optical or another source. Now, at this point, this system is done and it should be fully functioning. If it's not fully functioning, there are a couple things you can check. One, sometimes your amplifier will have a selection between RCA and XLR inputs. So like on this Topping A90, this does have a selection. So if I'm not hearing any sound, I can just make sure that it's trying to pick up the audio from the XLR and not the RCA. The second thing is that you can make sure that the volume on your DAC is all the way up if it does have a volume selection on it. The third thing you can try is going to the DAC's website to download a software update for the DAC. Sometimes these do need software updates. In every case, software updates are delivered almost exclusively through USB. Most DACs nowadays, though, are pretty good and are basically able to be up and running immediately. Now, last notes, there are all-in-one systems that you can plug in a USB and it has a DAC and an amplifier in one unit. They are fairly common. You can find them. If you want to buy a dedicated system, one thing to really watch out for is making sure that your output capability of the DAC matches your input capability or your input ports of the amplifier. So if you have an XLR DAC and an RCA amp, that's not really going to work. And vice versa. So you want to make sure that you have either RCA to RCA or XLR to XLR, just as a very baseline example. Okay, guys, thanks a lot for watching. Good luck on your hobby. I'll catch you guys in the next video.